My name is Nancy Dubois, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our facility design session with the Gender Equity Project at CPRA. We're going to give you a little bit of background before we get started, and then we'll get right into the content. So we're going to go into a little bit of a tech check at this point and give you an idea of some of the things that you might want to consider. I'm sure we're all Zoomed to death these days, but here's a bit to add to that. So we will be recording, as you've heard, the workshop, and this will go into the gender equity toolkit that's now up on the CPRA webpage. We would ask you if you would do two things with your sound and video. Leave your mute on unless it's a time when we want some interaction, and there will be a few of those throughout. The video, it would be really helpful if you're able to turn your video on. This is a workshop type format, so we are expecting that there's going to be some interaction and some interchange amongst us, and it is much easier to facilitate a session like this when we can see the participants. So if you're able to, that would be great. Most of you have your name already on your picture, so that's great. Add your pronouns if you'd like to do that. Play around with the view, so if you wanted to see just the speaker or the gallery of individuals, to do that, you've got a sliding bar likely around the middle of your screen. You can move it one side or the other to make either the people or the slides larger. In the chat box, we'll use that as we need throughout. We would ask that you don't insert any website URLs in there. There's a chance that it could spread viruses and things like that, so we just try and limit that if we can. And because of how many folks we have, which is great, we can't always see everybody on the same screen. So if you were indicating just with your waving hand, we might not see you. So if you are able to use the raise and lower hand icon on your screen, that will indicate to us, it brings you up to the top of the page so we know who's got their hand up. You find this in the reactions section at the bottom of your screen, and it's a toggle bar underneath all the various icons that just says raise hand. If you click that on to raise it, and then you can manually click it off when your point has been made or your comment's been recorded. Perfect. So I'm going to ask MJ to or Mary to share the video in just a second that Erin has put together as an overview of the project, a little bit about CPRA, and a little bit about the gender equity project that we'll have. And there will be an opportunity when we finish the video, it's not very long, to answer any questions that you might have about this.
Hi, and welcome. My name is Erin Love. I'm the Director of National Programs at the Canadian Parks and Recreation Association. I'm very pleased to welcome you today to the Gender Equity in Recreational Sport workshop series, focusing on optimizing facility use and design. These workshops are a culmination of efforts that over the last year and a bit have involved an environmental scan, a literature review, key informant interviews, and surveys involving researchers and recreation practitioners across Canada and internationally. Before we begin, I'd like to give you a brief introduction to CPRA and the work that we're doing focusing on gender equity in recreational sport. As many of you may know, the Canadian Parks and Recreation Association is the national organization dedicated to realizing the full potential of parks and recreation as major contributors to community health and vibrancy. CPRA is a voice. We are the national voice for parks and recreation, advancing the collective interests of our members. CPRA is a community. We're a national network dedicated to the well-being of people, communities in the natural and built environments. We are also a resource. So CPRA is a resource for the sector, and we contribute knowledge and opportunities to enhance growth. We'll talk a little bit more about that as well as I introduce the bench to you in a few slides. What makes CPRA so special is that we are a collective network of the 13 provincial and territorial Parks and Recreation Associations across Canada. They make up our membership, and our strength really comes from the experience, the expertise, and the network of the staff and board members that we have across this great country. We also work with volunteers, government partners, a number of allied health sector partners as well, such as public health, education, sport, physical activity, and a whole host of other groups. They help us progress on our goals, and in turn, we strive to help them meet theirs. CPRA has a virtual office with about 8 staff. And although the staff work remotely, the CPRA National Office is located on the unceded traditional territory of the Algonquin and Métis First Nations. We acknowledge the historical oppression of the lands, cultures, and the peoples in what we now know as Canada. And we aim to contribute to the healing and decolonizing journey that we all share together. So a moment ago, I referenced the Bench. The Bench is an online community that CPRA launched in the summer of 2020. It's a place for the sector to meet, to grow, to work, to share together. And the Bench features a whole host of different tools and resources. It's an events or a list of upcoming events. There are discussion groups, one in particular that's focused on gender equity. There are portals dedicated to specific projects, such as the Framework for Recreation in Canada and Parks for All. There are some professional development opportunities, and as well as COVID-19 and other resources. As the Bench grows, you'll also find other discussion groups start to pop up. So we really encourage you to sign up for the Bench, take a look around, join some discussion forums if some spark your interest. You'll also find some templates, some tools, some guidelines, and other documents to help you in the work that you're doing. And here's a video of the Bench. CPRA's current project that focuses on gender equity and recreational sport was funded back in November 2019. This funding came from the Government of Canada, from Sport Canada at the time, to increase participation and retention of women and girls in recreational sport in Canada. Through our work and over the past few years, we still, of course, focus on girls and women, but we've included non-binary folks as well in the work that we do. Our key populations for this work are girls aged 9 to 15, new mums or women in the postpartum period, older adults 55 and up, as well as girls and women with intersecting identity factors. And what we know is that these key priority groups face additional barriers to participation and retention. And the work that we're doing helps to address those and remove them. CPRA, as part of this work, has designed and delivered a number of different pieces to this project. So there is a facility use and design toolkit, of which this webinar series will be a part. There are other workshops that we've delivered in partnership with Canadian Women in Sport and some local facilitators across the country. We have also delivered a webinar series. You'll find all of this on our website and on our YouTube page. We've worked as well with High Five. Many of you may know the High Five training program, and we've enhanced a High Five sport module and also developed 4 new modules that practitioners can take. They're free, and I encourage you to check those out as well. We've also offered some community grants through this work. Those have gone to grassroots efforts across Canada to address those barriers that women, girls, and non-binary people face when participating in sport and recreation. there's a whole host of work that CPRA is doing in this area, and we would like to thank our partner, the Government of Canada, for funding to do all of these initiatives. This funding or this project supports the 2018 federal funding commitment to achieve gender equity in sport at every level by 2035. So with that, I will turn it over to my colleague and our workshop facilitator. I wish you all the best on this webinar, and I look forward to seeing you all on the bench.
Does anyone have any questions or comments about Erin's video there with the various aspects of the bigger project and CPRA in particular? Certainly feel free to write anything in the chat box as well. Nope, not hearing any. All right. I'd like to just give you a quick connection of this project to a broader framework for recreation in Canada that I'm sure many of you are already familiar with. It was developed in 2015 and is really a guiding principle document for where recreation is heading over the 10-year period following 2015. And you'll see here the five goals that relate to the framework. All five of them have a strong connection to gender equity. It's really a cross-cutting kind of approach to this. And so looking at whether we're talking about active living, certainly access and inclusion, and the concept of intersectionality that fits within that, connecting people in nature, which we've seen so much more of during our recent pandemic times, supportive environments, and the building of recreation capacity. So the physical activity needs and interests of women, girls, and gender diverse people do cross-cut all five of these goal areas. Just to take you now, I'm going to share with you some of the names and faces that you see here. We've got a team of five of us that are helping on various aspects of today's workshop. I'll introduce Mary in just a moment. We have Krista Costas-Bradstreet, and she and I have been the consulting team working on this project. Krista also does some work for CPRA. MJ, you'll see her picture on here. She's our technical guru in the background, and will pop in once in a while. And Erin, you've seen on the video. She's also joined us. I think we didn't hear the very beginning of the intro, and Erin is the manager of national projects with CPRA. I would like to, at this point, introduce to you our facilitator for today, Mary Chow. Mary is an architect and associate vice president with HDR, an architectural firm, who has dedicated the last 15 plus years of her career to designing recreation facilities. Firmly believing that community amenities must serve the stakeholders and demographics for which they are created, she truly engages the users and thoughtfully implements the best solutions into her work. Mary's track record of Facility of Excellence Awards is proof that she places client and community needs first. In addition to local venues, Mary has traveled internationally to give presentations on various issues related to community facility design, universal design, and how community engagement is being integrated into the architectural process. In the past few years, she has spoken at the Athletics Business Conference in Florida and New Orleans, the International Association for Sports and Leisure Facilities Congress in Germany, and the Association for International Sport for All World Congress in the Netherlands. Mary has been a pleasure to work with as we've developed the workshop for you today, and I'll turn things over to Mary at this stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nancy. I wanted to just start with saying that there should have been a couple of links and some relevant reading that was put out to everyone as you registered for this workshop. And one of them, I will encourage you to take a look at that if you haven't already. The first bullet point here, Go Where Women Are, is about engaging women in sport and exercise on their terms, in their space, whether physically or emotionally. And this review is authored by Sport England and explores our current understanding of women and their relevant motivations and what barriers and triggers there are in getting more active. So I really encourage you all to read it. It's a really easy to read, lots of graphics, great document for helping understand what the big issues are. The next two documents, a planning worksheet for this workshop, is really meant to help take an idea that's generated from this workshop or any of the other workshops in the series, and to create an action plan for making those ideas become real. And then finally, there is a temperature check that we will introduce, and we'll have a little activity around it in just a little bit later in our introduction.
Mary, if I could just interrupt for a second, MJ has put in the chat box the PDF for that Sport England document, and I wanted to just mention that we didn't send these out ahead of time with the registration, so you will be able to get them during the workshop, and you'll see as we move along. So if you didn't, where did it go? I didn't get it. We didn't send it. So you're not missing anything yet. Okay, sorry, over to you.
No problem. Thanks, Nancy, for that clarification. So this, as Nancy had mentioned, that this workshop is as much about sharing insights that all of you have had and concerns that you've seen in your facilities or in facility design that you know have come up through your customers. And it's not so much for us as talking heads here for us to sort of talk to you about what has been done, but more so this engagement through this workshop in sharing ideas. So the workshop actually is going to be a component of presenting some content, workshopping and discussing applications of ideas, and then taking some learnings and examples and stories from our presentation here and from all of you as well. I wanted to just take a note that this workshop is fairly long, and so we are going to have a break, about a 10-minute break at the halfway mark. So that's 10:30 Pacific time. I'm here in Vancouver, and 1:30 Eastern time. And some of you may be over in the Maritimes as well. So a bit of a time check. I'd like to sort of share this early example project that really is about more than just exercise and sport in facility design. And what we are finding and seeing and hearing from groups is some barriers to participation in sport and exercise sort of include fear of judgment, fear of not being able to perform, appearance, concern about the appearance when you are exercising or in a sport environment, and not able to prioritize exercise over other commitments. And so in this project at the City of Richmond, what the client or the City of Richmond really wanted to do was to create spaces for girls, women, and those who actually aren't so used to coming into recreation facilities or wanting to do that, and creating this space that is central to the facility, but not necessarily directly in view of the reception desk. And so there is a little bit of privacy sort of involved in having a space like this. And so the idea is here is to bring people in into a facility that is comfortable and welcoming, and creating that sense of warmth and a familiarity when you come into a new facility. Once this happens, then opening up programming to those people who don't usually come in becomes much more easy. And so this is just an early example that we wanted to present. At this part of the presentation, we are going to be using Mural throughout the workshop. And inside of your chat, it should be the very first message to everyone, should be a link to get you into the Mural. So the Mural is a virtual sort of like a pinboard where we can share ideas by having you go in and interact with it directly. And I'll just sort of quickly pull it up so that you can see what it looks like. And so some of you on this call are already in here. So this is the entire Mural board. You should be able to just click on that link, come on in. You will be able, once you come in, you should be able to click on your visiting animal or character and add your name. That would be appreciated. So, you know, this is meant to be a discussion. So please add your name as a visitor here. And just come and take a look around. So we're going to have a number of exercises, and we'll just give everyone a moment to come in. And then as you are doing that, We're going to do just a quick little mural exercise to get you familiar with the board for all of those who have not come in. And so what you'll see in the sort of left-hand side of the mural board is you should be able to zoom or scroll into an activity that looks like this. So what I'm going to get you to do is to click on one of these yellow squares and just add your name into that square. And then once you've done that, you should be able to change the color of this little rectangle to either orange, purple, or green. So orange means that your current facility status, you're here because you have a new build that's coming up in the future. And this is one of the reasons why you are at this workshop. The purple sort of represents you are in a renovation. And so that's one of the reasons why you're here. You're thinking about renovating to better promote gender equity. And the third is you're looking for a quick win. You actually have a facility that you have, and you're looking to see what are those quick wins that you can implement into your existing facility so that you can incorporate some sort of gender equity features or components into that facility. Okay, so I'm just going to bring up this other screen here very quickly, and let's just see how we're doing with this introduction. Lovely here. And if you are not doing one or the other, or new build, renovation, quick win, that's okay. You can just sort of leave yourself as yellow. And I see our CPRA folks are showing themselves in blue, which is great. That's awesome. And I just have a question to everyone. Is there anyone who's having a problem getting into the mural activity, or if you prefer not to, we sort of encourage you to come in because we're going to have other activities where we're looking for your input. But if anyone's having any issues, just please let us know.
Mary, I think a couple people are still trying to get in.
Okay. So I'm going to paste the link again.
I've just done that, Mary.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. And Mylene would like you to repeat how to write the names.
Okay. You can just, if you can see my mouse here, you can just click on any one of these squares. Once you click on it, you can just begin typing. And you can see this is pretty interactive. There will be some things you can move and other things that you cannot, just to keep the board a little organized. So I'm seeing here that there's a few people who are going to be working on a renovation. There's some people here looking at a quick win. Jen and Bradley are going to be working on a new build, which is always super exciting. This is great. We just give it another minute or so. And great to see everyone moving around in here. Okay. And you can stay inside of this mural. It'll be open for the entire workshop and presentation. But for now, what I'll do is we'll go over to the next slide. Krista?
Thanks, Mary. So just to set a little bit of context, and I think probably many of you will be familiar with some of these stats. I think I somehow got muted in the middle of that. So we just wanted to give you a little bit of context and why this issue is so important, because I think we have a sense that it's important, but from what we've heard from some of our recreation colleagues is that we still, you know, sometimes in the decision-making process, we need to be convincing people that gender equity is in fact an issue, even though in physical activity, sport, and recreation, even though we know women and girls make up 50% of the population. So according to the Canadian Women in Sport Rally report that was released in June of 2020, so much of the surveying and stuff would have happened just before that, which is of course just before COVID. But I'm not sure if it took into account some of what was happening, but they found that 62% of Canadian girls were not participating in any kind of sport. And then when you look at the second bullet point, which talks about the fact that in 1992, half of women were participating, and by 2020, 18% of women were participating. So again, I know that we did have a lockdown and people weren't able to participate, but that would not, I don't think at the time that this report was done, account for that significant of a drop. We know that similar numbers of boys and girls start out in sport, but in fact, boys stay involved longer through to adolescence. And we know we lose boys from sport as well in adolescence, but significantly more girls we lose at adolescence, and they remain less active throughout their lives. So you can see the stat here, 1 in 3 girls drop out versus 1 in 10. Factors that prevent girls from participating include low confidence, negative body image, poor perceptions of belonging, and a feeling of unwelcomeness. And this is actually this stat around this, or this notion of feeling unwelcome. We're hoping that through the 4 workshops that we're doing, we'll address some of those reasons why they feel unwelcome, and facility design and use, or facility design is one of them. So then in the next slide, we've got the fact that this is, and again, this was a specific COVID study that Canadian Women in Sport did after the rally report. And what they found is that 1 in 4 females are not committing to returning to sport after COVID-19. And in some cases, it's because they said, you know what, I haven't been involved for so long, and I'm just not interested in coming back. It maybe didn't suit really my needs in the first place. And now I've found some other things to do. So there's a number of reasons why people, why women are not and girls are not returning, but 1 in 4, that's a big number. Probably should have had this stat even before the others. And that's because overall, what we know is that through the lifespan, women and girls are less active than boys and men at every age through the lifespan. So men take more steps than women do, and men are tend to get or meet the Canadian physical activity guidelines of 150 minutes a week more so than women do. And then finally, just in terms of setting the context for this, and Mary mentioned this at the very beginning when she started off, and that is this whole fear of judgment. And I can't remember if you'll hear this in one of the videos, but some of the work that Sport England has done has talked about this fear. And so fear of judgment, fear of ability, how you look in front of other people. So this notion of there, or this theme of fear, which is... it seems a little bit, I mean, it seems crazy that this is what's stopping people from being physically active or participating in sports. So we have a lot of work to do, I think, when it comes to this, this whole notion of fear, because we know sport, physical activity, recreation is supposed to be fun, not fearful. And all of this really leads us to the fact that we do have a 2035 goal of increasing gender equity by this year. It's not that far away. I think when we started working on this, we thought, wow, 2035, but it's coming up pretty quick. And there is budget money for it. As you can see, there's budget 2018 where there was money committed for this. There are a number of organizations that are working on this priority. We think that we've got an opportunity to coordinate some of those efforts. And then we know that some of you are doing some of this really important work provincially, territorially, and in your local organizations. We would love to know more about that work as well. And so if there's things that you're doing around gender equity that you'd love to share with us, please do. And you can do that by emailing us at info@cpra.ca. And I think that's it for me.
Thanks, Krista. So what we wanted to do right now is to talk a little bit about the gender equity temperature check. So one of the things about the temperature check is having all of you on the call and those in your organization that are interested in gender equity, understand where are you relative to moving along on this journey towards gender equity. So I just would like to take a quick sort of screen share with you as to what this gender equity temperature check looks like. So it does come in a Word document, and it is quite comprehensive and takes you through a whole number of questions. And then at the end, you will be able to score yourself in terms of understanding where you sort of sit in terms of gender equity. So the assessment is really about having you learn and understand where your organization is at, understand where you have strengths and where you have opportunities to grow. And then, of course, it's always about identifying priorities and strategies towards advancing gender equity. So at this point, we want to do a little mural activity, which is this temperature check. And I just wanted, or we had wanted you all to sort of understand, you know, what some of the questions are like in that, to encourage you to see what those, how the questions can help you sort of really think deeply about your organization and where your organization is at on this journey. And so in the mural, you're going to see a large blue rectangle. There are six questions in here. This check mark and sort of the thumbs down is actually clickable. So you should be able to click on this. And if you left click it, you should be able to duplicate this. You can also find this as an icon on the left-hand side of your screen, but you should just be able to click and duplicate this and drag it to one of these squares. And so what we're looking for is, if you do have a gender equity policy and an implementation plan, you know, click on one of these check marks, duplicate that and pull that into the box, and do that for each one of these questions. If you don't have that, you know, you can do a thumbs down and move that into the box. So I'm just going to bring up the mural board as well, just so that you can see where it's located. So we were there, and I love it. Some people are already beginning to utilize this. Yes. So you should be able to take any one of these items. And what I will do is I will add, the other thing I can do is add a few more of these icons. You can sort of see in the left here. And you can sort of duplicate this a couple of times. I'm going to bring this over to here. And so if you want, you can just drag one of these additional icons from the top into one of these squares. So that's another way that you can do that. Oop. I'm losing my thumbs down. So we'll just give you a moment, and so we can sort of see here that what we're sort of seeing here right now is that, in fact, many of you actually don't have a gender equity policy. And that's actually something that gets discussed, you know, in some of these workshops here in terms of organizational culture. It does look like that there is about 50-50, maybe a little bit more, in terms of consulting women and girls to ensure that, you know, their voices are heard in the development of programs and needs and facility design. And I think that's really great, because oftentimes a perspective is not understood until you actually are able to bring those people in, perhaps a gap in your programming or a gap in your facility design can sort of be understood and realized when you hear firsthand from girls and women and gender diverse populations as to what those concerns are. So that's about 50-50. As well, this is about 50-52 in terms of accommodating unique and intersecting needs of women and girls in terms of cultural needs. And that's quite good. We're seeing that more and more. It's more of a discussion point as to whether or not an organization wants to do that, and we'll talk a little bit more about intersectionality and what that means to gender equity a little bit later in the presentation too. Programs that are designed specifically to meet the unique needs of girls and women, that's about 50-50 of you in this workshop. We have a dedicated budget line to invest. And so usually there's no budget identified to this, but there is a check mark here. And I'm going to ask the person who provided this check mark, are you able to unmute yourself and maybe talk a little bit to the group, if you're able, as to what is this budget and what has it been allocated for? If you're able to unmute yourself. For the person who's added this check mark in. Okay, we're just going to move on. If you are willing to share, if you can actually add that into the chat, I think that is something that would be interesting to the group as to what type of budget and what extent there is that has been added to your organization to sort of implementing some strategies. Okay, so I'm just going to reshare this presentation. And so this one is over to you, Krista.
Sorry about that. I keep thinking I'm not on mute. So in terms of, benefits of increasing girls, women, and gender diverse people's participation in sport. I think, and I mentioned this in my earlier comments, that sport, physical activity, recreation is supposed to be fun. It's the number one reason that we continue to participate. So we want to make sure that we're generating a positive environment for the participation of girls and women and gender diverse people. A decreased dropout rate of girls, women, and gender diverse people via gender-friendly guidance and coaching, avoiding sexist gender stereotypes, and creating a positive social atmosphere, again, are those things that are going to help us to continue to retain girls, but also, I think, bring girls in the first place. Many girls and women will participate because their friends are participating, because they've heard by word of mouth that the program is good, that it's safe, that it's welcoming, and all of those kinds of things. So we want to make sure that we're not only bringing or retaining girls and women in sport and physical activity, but also bringing them in the first place. And then again, an increased sensitivity to a wider range of potential participants, many of whom have been excluded in the past. And when we talked earlier about that fear that people have experienced, some of those have contributed to their perceptions of sport. Many of you may have gone participated in physical education. You may have been on a team where you were, that whole thought of being picked last, or probably most of you aren't as old as I am and went through Canada's Fitness Awards where you had to do the flexed arm hang where everybody watched you do it, and so on. So people have had some not great experiences in an activity that, again, should be really positive and fun. So there's many benefits to keeping women and girls involved in sport. And of course, we want them to be healthy. We want them to be socially active and socially connected. And so it's a really clearly for me an issue that we need to all work together to increase people's chances of participating in the first place and then remaining active and involved throughout their lifespan. So again, 10 top ways to increase participation, empowering local communities and neighborhoods. And many of you may come from the community setting and be doing some really cool work in this regard. And so again, if you want to share what you're doing with us, that would be awesome. Marketing campaigns and communications. I think they're important. For sure, they have a place. They're part of the bigger picture in the puzzle. But we want to make sure that what we are hearing is people's word of mouth to say, yeah, we had a great experience. Taster sessions and classes. So let people try things out without making an actual commitment. Sometimes the very first step is just even coming to watch something, not even having to participate. Just come, sit, watch what we're doing, and enjoy. Community engagement with partner organizations. You never know where we can reach different folks to come out and tell them about the programs, and maybe where they are already going are the places where we should be offering some of these programs. Having coaches and professionals who are well-trained, who are aware of and are comfortable with working with women and girls and how to make them feel comfortable and ensuring that those fears that they're experiencing are dealt with and not realized in the end. Improving facilities highlighted, because that's what we're talking about today, not only from what it looks like, what the design of the facility is, but are the times that girls and women able to use the facility ones that are conducive to their schedule. So, you know, and years ago, I wanted to play hockey. Well, hockey for me was going to be 11 o'clock p.m. on a Sunday night. So it's not the best timing. And making sure that, again, the best, you know, fields and arenas aren't always going traditionally to what's been done for the last 75 years, but figuring out who makes up your community and when they need to be, what suits them to be more active. Mentioned social marketing approach a little bit when we talked about marketing campaigns and communications. So again, taking those principles of, you know, selling a product to selling a cause. And in our case, it's physical activity, sport, and recreation. Strong leadership always. And more what we want to do is ensure that women and girls are in leadership positions. So we're still not seeing fully that women and girls are in those leadership positions. When they are, it's their voice that's being reflected and helping to ensure that women and girls are coming on board as well. Help people use their peer network. So again, the more that at a certain time, I think parents always have a role in encouraging their girls to participate, or their kids in general to participate. But at a certain time, we tend to lean on our peers. So the more we can rely on that social network, the better. And then workplaces are great opportunities to get people active, whether it's actually through encouraging active transportation, whether it's programs themselves that take place at workplaces. So, and again, then you've got built-in peer support there. So lots of different ways to increase participation. And I think there's tons more, but anyway, this just gives you a quick list to start. So, and I mentioned this at the very beginning, that now more than ever, we need to strengthen our efforts to increase female participation in sport and recreation, that we do have this goal, so that we want to achieve gender equity in sport and recreation by 2035. If we can do this together with all of your efforts, with what we're doing at the national level, what's happening provincial and territorially, I think we're going to see some real progress in this area.
Thanks, Krista. So this workshop will actually focus on key components related to gender equity and the design of recreation facilities, as we've discussed. And so I just want to sort of give a little sort of roadmap to what's upcoming. Is we want to consider gender equity much earlier than when we're actually within the facility design stage. In many cases, as we've sort of seen in the mural, and where we're looking for quick wins and we're looking to retrofit facilities to be more gender equitable, you know, I think that moving forward, thinking about gender equity prior to any sort of renovation or new build is actually going to really strengthen this and encourage that type of participation that, or more equitable participation that we're looking for. We're also going to be taking a look at methods to make a case for facility design changes in support of gender equity. We want to talk a little bit about how we discover or understand what are those ideas we want to implement, analyzing through costs as well as, you know, opportunities and challenges or burden and benefit, thinking through really the opportunities that are there. And then once the changes are made, doing an evaluation and accountability as to what were the real impacts of those changes, and then assessing and reporting. And actually, Nancy does do a workshop on this. It's the following workshop that really talks about that accountability and that evaluation.
Mary, I think there's a question for you as well.
Okay.
Maeva, did I pronounce your name properly?
Oh, you're on mute, Maeva.
Yes, hi. About the first presentation about gender neutral facilities, I have a question. In the neighborhood in which I work, we have made in a swimming pool, we have made a gender neutral changing room. So all of the changing room is now gender neutral. And I would like to know if you have more studies about, you know, now some facilities have implemented gender neutral changing rooms. What is the literature? I mean, have you done studies? Now it's more implemented. Is it still, you know, I have a lot of questioning about how women feel in a mixed changing room. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have, for example, in a park, there is a big toilet, and I would, you know, would like to know if it's a big toilet, but there is nobody that checks what's happening in the toilet. So would mm-hmm. women feel comfortable in a place mm-hmm. that is mixed? So I know there is a lot of pros for mixed facilities. But I always have, and I have a lot of questions from people around me
mm-hmm. I think about that. That is a great question. And I'll just sort of make some comments right now. And if you want to discuss it a little bit more afterwards, we can sort of exchange emails or a way for us to connect. And there may be others sort of in this group that have comments as well. We do a lot of stakeholder engagement before we make the decision to go to full gender neutral or what we call universal design in terms of swimming pool facilities or even in community center where there are no swimming pool facilities. And I would argue that in all of the work that we do, there are very, very few facilities that want to go full gender neutral. And so what we are beginning to find is that there is, where we're trying to create this fully inclusive environment, which is your changing room environment, it's actually not, it's not inclusive for certain groups. And so an example could be, and I'll give a couple examples to this because these were very real examples and requests from facility owners, was we had one facility that had, that really catered to the local schools. And so they were bringing in school children of all sorts of varying ages for swim lessons through in this small community through the week. And the teachers basically said, we're not mixing the genders. It's very, very difficult for us to sort of control these large groups of kids. And so for that facility, there about half of the change rooms were universal or sort of, you know, gender neutral. And about one quarter was dedicated female and one quarter was dedicated male. And that sort of suited that facility. The other is a community that is potentially has a slightly older population. And they basically said, we are just not used to wanting to share. And we don't want to be sharing a universal facility that is can be used men or women. And then there are also incidences as well as a crime happening in those universal change rooms as well, right? So we have to be very careful in the design that we create more privacy as opposed to less privacy. So I think your question is really good. We are finding that it is, we are finding where we thought maybe 5 or 7 years ago that the trend was to go to all gender neutral. Is that we're finding that choice actually is what people are looking for to make them more comfortable. So if you're going to create an environment where women aren't comfortable sharing universal change rooms with men, then they won't come to your facility. So it's really about understanding the community. I hope that answered your question. And we can talk a little bit more about it in specifics if you would like.
Yes, great. I would be very happy to speak more about that.
Okay. And so maybe what we'll do is, Nancy or Krista, is there a way for me to, or for us to sort of get Maeva's information?
And connect you.
Yeah. That's great. Okay, thank you. So just continuing on with the presentation, we are going to give some project examples about gender equity, and then we will take some questions and share some stories at the end of the presentation. I wanted to sort of just make this statement is that our belief is that design is never neutral and that gender equity should be embedded in everything that we do. And also to make the differentiation between equity and equality. So equity and equality have long been used interchangeably, but the terms are often confused with each other. The focus of equity is to make everything the same, and that's the end goal. But equity may be defined as a way in which all people, regardless of their social economic situation, their race, their ethnicity, their gender, have a fair and just access to all of the resources and opportunities necessary to thrive. So we often sort of think about equity and equality just slightly differently. And so this statement too was really resonated with me because I felt that, you know, in the design work that we did, I felt like there was quite a bit of equity and equality in the facility design, but we were finding that there weren't so many female voices at the table when we were sometimes doing engagement or sometimes, you know, in the design profession. And so gender equity still favors men if consideration of what women really need is not considered. And you can also even add gender diverse or non-binary populations in there too. So if we don't consider these voices, then it's still not really equal. So we do want to talk a little bit about intersectionality because we've come to realize that gender is not the only lens that is creating a barrier for participation in sport and exercise. And so the CPRA actually has this great video clip on intersectionality. We did show a clip of it at our first workshop, but now what we will encourage you to do, because that was only a snippet, is that we're encouraging you to go, it's on YouTube, in order to take a look at that intersectionality video to really understand the meaning of it. And I hope that we can add that to the chat. So maybe MJ can do that so that you can go and take a look at it after this workshop. And so the idea about intersectionality is that it's a framework for conceptualizing a group of people or a social problem and that's affected by a number of discriminations and disadvantages. And it takes into account people's overlapping identities and experiences in order to understand the complexity of prejudices that they face. So what we really want to do in this next mural activity is we want to sort of talk about intersectionality a little bit, because what we're finding is that when you think about girls, women, and gender diverse populations, that is not all that they are experiencing. And that's not all of the sort of barriers that's preventing them from participation. So I'm going to encourage everyone to jump back into the mural board again. And you will see that just beside the temperature check is this little circle on intersectionality. And I would sort of encourage you to, type into one of these circles, and you can sort of add more circles or squares or whatever you want, and talk about the different lenses that actually can intersect with the concept of gender. So a really easy one, that often gets talked about is race or culture, right? And so as a woman, if you come from a certain race or culture, you have that lens that actually gets put upon you. And so your view of a facility actually is more than just your gender. It has some others, it has some sort of other lenses associated with it. And I can see that the stickies or the little circles are being populated. And so encourage you all to spend a moment and add to that. So I see age group. I agree with that, because what we're finding is that young girls tend to be encouraged by parents to participate in sport in North America. That is a tendency, but they get to a certain age group when they make their decisions and they drop out of sport. Or we could see that, you know, when you have young children as a woman, that in that age group, you may be limited in terms of your time. And so exercise becomes not as important to you as caregiving for your family. So I think age group is really interesting. The other I see here is ability, the various different abilities of a gender or of girls, you know, as compared to boys, let's say. That is a lens that actually gets placed upon. It could also be that you have, as a woman, you also have a mobility issue. And so that is another lens that gets put on top of the your actual identity in terms of your gender. There's sexual orientation, and I think that's great. There's language, culture, religion, physical health, a relationship and status. So if you're married or unmarried, I think that also is very important. Okay, we'll just sort of give it another second or so. And this is the second workshop that we're holding here. And we did this exercise in the first workshop as well. And I'm just going to actually add a little bit more voices to this. And just sort of move this down. And so you can sort of see what are some of the other sort of lenses that we had in that first workshop here. So marital status came up, physical health, I think, was here. Trauma was one that came up. I think that was quite interesting. So depending on the trauma that you have, you may have that as a barrier. Family status was there. There was status as well. Age, we sort of talked about that. This rural and urban, I thought that was very interesting too, because, you know, depending on if you are in a rural community or urban community, that could actually sort of add to sort of how you sort of perceive facilities and your barriers or opportunities for participation. Learning disability. Income, socioeconomic status, that was there. Oh, so there are definitely some similarities and some good ones that came out of the first workshop as well. Okay, so thank you for that. All right. So moving on, we are going to actually have a breakout session now. And MJ, can you remind me, if people choose not to be part of the breakout room discussion, that they can continue to stay in the waiting room? Is that correct?
They could. So we will move everyone into a breakout room though.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, so we are going to have a breakout room discussion for 5 minutes. And what we want to do now is we've sort of talked about the various different lenses in that last activity. And we want to talk about these lenses as they present themselves as an opportunity or a barrier to participation in sport and recreation facilities. And so will we have 4 breakout rooms, MJ?
Yep. Yes, we will. Mary, I've got them ready to go.
Okay, that's great. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly pull up the mural board again. You'll sort of see here that this is this first breakout room, and the question is listed. And we just want to have a discussion about opportunities and barriers. And so feel free to sort of move around to where we talked about the various different lenses. And just take a look and have a discussion about those opportunities and barriers.
Okay, so you'll get an invitation shortly to join a breakout room. And then, Mary, did you say 5 minutes we're going to work on this?
Yes.
So at the 4-minute mark, you'll see a message come up in your breakout rooms, and it will close in 60 seconds after that.
And okay. then what we'll do is we'll just ask someone from each room to spend a minute or two, maybe talking about some of the highlights from the breakout session.
Okay, so are we ready to go?
Yes, and I will stop sharing.
Okay, here we go. Have fun.
And what I'll do is I'll do a share of a couple of the comments that came out of our breakout room. And Mava, maybe you can finish your last sentence for us all, if that's okay. I can put you on the spot a little bit. Okay. All right. And the one question I have, is everyone still seeing my presentation, or is it just unshared at this point?
Unshared.
It's okay. Unshared. Yep.
All right. I can't quite tell. So I'm just going to reshare that to remind everyone of the question. Okay. And for us here, we actually had 5 minutes and we talked about three different barriers. One was age, the other was ability, and then the history of the facility. So in terms of age, just that teenager girls, they develop a little bit earlier than boys and they begin to want to socialize more, or their interests begin to change and they start differentiating themselves from boys. And so with the different interests, you know, things that were very important to them at a young age is not as important to them as they develop. And then older women who are not involved in sports, they, when they're young, they feel like they're not capable of participating. And so they don't do that. So for ability, girls think that they can't do it. And so that really is a barrier. So it's really a perception of themselves. And then boys who are very good at the sport, that becomes a conflict. So either a conflict when the girl is actually very good physically, it becomes very competitive, like why is she so good? And so you compete, or the girls aren't as good. And so there's less desire to want to be inclusive in those sports. And then we had a very interesting discussion about the history or the heritage of the facility and how spaces and programs are not geared towards new programming that is very of interest to the different genders. And so so we sort of, someone had said, I can't remember if that was Mava or Genevieve, said, you know, we have these sports fields, but we don't have anything for yoga as an example. And so that's not allowing people to come in and participate. And Mava, you had a last comment, and I didn't really want to cut you off.
Oh, no, it's fine. You have resumed my so thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. So I'm just going to move over to Erin and see if she can, Erin, if you can just give a quick 1 or 2 minute summary. And Erin, if you're speaking, you are on mute. Okay, so maybe what we'll do is we'll switch over to Nancy.
Sorry, I was on mute. I won't go through the ones that are have our repeats of what you had come up with, Mary, in your room. But we have the physical health and ability were both opportunities and barriers, depending on the state of both of those. So you already addressed ability and physical health, probably fairly obvious, whether it be based on age or whatnot. So those were both. It was interesting, but the whole idea of language and culture, we talked a little bit about in terms of people coming from other than a North American experience may not have the same value for recreation and or specific activities. So if they're used to not playing soccer where they come from, and the kids, they want to put them in activities here in Canada, and the soccer is just not something they're familiar with. Depending on what age they are, they may be sort of developmentally from a skills perspective much more of a beginner than that. I thought it was interesting that the one at the bottom, the low income, offered an opportunity. So it was potentially a barrier to participation, but it gives the facility or the organization a chance to offset the cost. So it's an opportunity to do something practical to overcome that barrier. And then the transportation one, it had many dimensions to it. It could be about just surely being able to get to the activities. It may be related to the location, the rural urban piece. It might be related to the cost of public transportation or lack thereof. And that word that's spelled incorrectly should be weather. So depending on how the or where the facilities are located, weather may be a problem. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, was the body image issue as a barrier.
That's great.
Okay.
Thanks, Nancy. Krista, did you want to share?
Well, we also had 5 minutes, but given that most of my career in this sector has been on partnership and relationship building, we did spend some time getting to know one another. And then all of a sudden, 5 minutes is gone. But it's cool. Lots of people from all across the country doing different work. So really interesting. But what we did is we focused a little bit in on age. And so I think some of it's been talked about, but we saw it as both an opportunity and a barrier. Opportunity in that sometimes age, and maybe as we age, we feel more confident to be able to share our perspective and share our needs, and so those perhaps older women are better able to, or are the strongest voices and better able to say what they need. And we also talked about the fact that, yeah, it's, you know, as young women, maybe I think somebody mentioned ability, or maybe we are less confident to talk about what we want. And then depending on the phases of our lives and the circumstances, there's different times where we feel a little bit more able to explain what we need and want, and then less time at other points in that journey. And then that whole intergenerational aspect where women are often the ones that are caring for both kids and parents. And I put this in the barrier category because that might interfere with our ability to participate, depending on, again, what that life circumstance is with that sandwich generation. So and that often it's the trends that are happening in society in general, that we tend to lean towards specific groups whose needs might be what we're hearing more in from a societal point of view.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Thanks, Krista. I did want to go back to Erin's group. If not Erin, someone from her group, if anyone wanted to sort of talk about some of the lenses. So, you know, it's great to see there's definitely some similarities, cultural diversity, transportation. That's a great one that came up, cost, lack of facilities, access to facilities. But there's one that's a little bit different, Indigenous identity. Cool. And whether that is that a barrier, and how is it as a barrier? I don't know if someone wants to speak to that, or if not, just put some thoughts into the chat. That would be great to share with everyone, because I think that's an important one that we're all sort of facing at this point.
That wasn't mine, but I could speak to, we've had some meetings with elders in our community to talk about how they feel about our facility and how we can make it more welcoming. And it really was about being able to, that they see themselves reflected in the facility and in the spaces and places that we create. And so that's something that I know we've been working on in our community.
Mm-hmm. I think that's great. Thanks for sharing that, Christina. I feel like that comment that you just said about making, it's almost like the facility reflects your identity in some way. And I think that is very true for women and girls as well, is that they feel that, you know, it reflects their identity. And so they feel very included or welcomed when they come to that space. So I think that's a great comment. Okay, I'm just going to continue on with our presentation. And I love this quote by Lisa O'Keefe, where she sort of talks about solutions that are designed for everybody are designed for nobody. And this is the one comment that we were making when we were talking about universal or gender-free change in washrooms, right? So if you say everyone fits into this group and everyone will be comfortable here, then it really, you really begin to think, who are you actually designing for? And another, as we're talking about intersectionality, you know, these ideas come up quite a bit. Women are primary caregivers or children, they still are, you know, and I think for most people, they still, even though a lot of women now sort of also work, there's still a bias towards women taking care of children, more likely to be carers of for people with a disability, less likely to participate in active recreation, as we've heard earlier in the presentation, and more likely to feel unsafe in the public realm. And that has a lot to do with access and transportation as well. And so in this next presentation, slides, we're going to actually, we conducted a number of interviews from various groups across Canada who actually were already beginning to look at gender neutrality, like story about gender equity in their facilities. And so there's just a couple of different examples. This video clip is from Sport Nova Scotia, and it's an example of how this organization is being very intentional in bringing gender equity into existing facilities. So just-
Mary? Yes. Could you just share the computer sound? Because I don't think it's currently shared.
Okay, so let me just give me 1 second here.
Yep, there you go.
Okay, and so you can see that, so that's great. Thank you.
Yeah, one thing to point out is we're still in the pilot phase of the tool. So we have facilities now that are going through the self-assessment and kind of measuring where they're at and where they should celebrate some success, but also where they should do some work. So really what we're asking the facilities to do is really reflect on the design. Most of these facilities are older facilities and have gone through maybe some upgrades in the past few years or are scheduled to do some upgrades. We're really wanting them to think about females not just as participants, as users of facilities, but also as board members, as coaches, as leaders of programs, as staff people, as people who can really help enhance the whole well-being of the facility and ultimately the community that they're looking at. You know, looking at the physical accessibility as well, around showers and washrooms and doors and you know, change rooms and things like having accessible seating stations, not just for women or people who associate as being a woman, but for men as well, because it doesn't always have to be the woman who is feeding a baby.
And we've got one more video clip. This is Erin from the town of Aurora. And Erin speaks on specific characteristics of spaces that provides an environment that encourages women and girls to participate.
Couple of key elements within here where we've looked at, okay, what do we need to consider from a facility perspective that could impact and assist in us moving forward in this gender equity project? So one is looking at the spaces and looking at how do we make the spaces private from the general public? So we look at within our facilities, as an example, one of the discussions that's already taken place is our pools and privacy curtains and privacy blinds. So having those discussions and doing some preliminary research and the cost associated with that. So we could have a space that women and girls can come and participate in aquatics programs where the general public that may be walking through the facility is not able to see within that space, it provides a comfortable environment to participate. So that is an example. And as well as even within our gyms and being able to see the one gym that we do currently have, do we have the ability to cover any windows when we are running female specific programming and the impact that could have? So those are some of the things we've started to look at in terms of existing spaces. As well, starting to look at even things like allocation of spaces. What are the times that female programming are running, or when do our female-only programs have access to facilities and the quality of the facility? So again, just started to sort of say, okay, these are things we need to look at, but have not formalized any approach to how we look at them or implemented any plan, but recognize it can impact. And it goes back to when we talked earlier about sort of the process. If we're going to make change, introduce new programs, the space is key. And so we may introduce a new program, but if we haven't provided the environment for them to participate in a safe way, it is not going the full road down. So even looking at launching a new program in January in our gym, can we cover the windows, and is that going to impact and allow for individuals to be more open to participate? We are at the town building a new gym, a double gym at one of our facilities. And so we are just in sort of, again, not even in the design phase yet. So knowing that this design is coming up, and because I myself am focusing on gender equity and working on that project, I identified, okay, let's look at this from a gender equity lens. Let's consider, before we get into the design phase, what are some elements that we could consider? And so that has come up as a preliminary comment when we get to that stage. So something that we'll keep back of the mind, and this project and working on this is something that we're like, wait, we have this opportunity here to look at future designs and how we design it that could impact participation.
Okay, so we're actually coming up very close to our halfway point to the presentation, and there is one more mural activity that we'd like to do, but we're sort of close. So I'm willing to, Nancy and Krista, what do you think? We can do this this one activity now, or we can actually do it after the break. Any thoughts on that?
Let's go after the break, since you've teased people now with the break.
Okay, will do. So I have a couple of slides here. We'll insert the break here. And what I'll do is I will put up a screen, and then I'll actually put a timer as we're getting close to the end of our 10 minutes. So we'll give everyone 10 minutes and there'll be a little bit of a clock that counts down as you're coming back, so you know when to rejoin us. So everyone have a break, and we'll see you back in 10 minutes. So we wanted to talk a little bit about this next mural activity. And I would like to actually do the mural activity combined with the breakout room. And I think that actually would work much better. So the idea here is that we want to take those lenses that we had just looked at in terms of intersectionality and really start to be able to translate that into facility design. You know, sometimes when we say, oh, age is an issue. As a woman, you know, maybe I didn't participate in sport when I'm young, and so I feel like there's an issue for me to participate in sport now. How can facility design help to remove a barrier there? So that's maybe not so easy, but I can give a couple of examples. It could be that you start in smaller groups for a specific focus group. And so maybe that means that you need different types of multipurpose room sizes within your facility, right? So, you know, it could be that a woman who's not very comfortable with physical activity is going to want, you know, to start out smaller with a smaller group, more sort of interpersonal connections with people to get them more comfortable with the facility. And so, you know, not having a multi-purpose room that is, let's say, 2,000 square feet for a group of six people, you want something smaller. So we start thinking about how we can take an opportunity and barrier and bring that into facility design. So just before we start the activity and the breakout room, just want to talk a little bit about gender mainstreaming, and we're not going to go into detail as to what that is, but it's really about bringing gender into the mainstream. And so there's just more awareness of it. And there's some system-wide actions that I think are quite appropriate to facility design. One is to champion that female perspective in engagement in design, so you really truly understand what women and girls and gender diverse individuals are looking for. Creating an enabling environment that prizes diversity and flexibility and provides equal opportunity. And I think one thing that is important too is the allocation of fields and spaces, reassessing government funding allocation and subsidies for male and female sports. That's not a facility issue, but sometimes facilities need to accommodate the reassessment of that government funding in terms of the programming. And then encourage diversity and gender parity in committees responsible for the design of facilities. Okay, so I'm just going to bring up the mural board again. Here. And just to sort of show you, we're going to actually be working in this sort of breakout room, these boxes here. But also you can also use this opportunities and barriers here. In the last breakout room, we sort of talked about what opportunities and barriers can be. Sometimes they're like a real strong opportunity. Sometimes they're a barrier. So feel free to use this as a scratch board and everyone can be adding to this. And then in the breakout room, we're gonna want to talk about how do we build a supportive environment that maximizes on opportunities and minimizes on barriers. And this is really taking those ideas that were generated in the last breakout room session and sort of saying how can the facility design really sort of support these? And then we can add more ideas and lenses, or we can just focus on the ones we've done. MJ, are you going to be putting everyone in the same breakout room? I think that's how we did it the last workshop.
Actually, no, we've had people join and others leave, so I've recreated.
Okay. So that's fine then. Groups.
Are we ready to go? What sort of timing are we going with, Mary?
I think 5 minutes is good, just because I have reshuffled a little bit. And so a 4 minute sort of check-in would be great. And then I'll ask someone from each of the breakout rooms to also summarize when we come back together. Hi, everyone. Welcome back. That was the fastest 5 minutes that I think I've ever gone through. We had only a couple of comments from our group. And so I'm just taking a quick look here. And I think what I'll do is, Nancy, if you're ready, I'll get you to maybe give a bit of a summary as what was sort of discussed.
Sure. We talked about different kinds of spaces. So small versus large, gender specific and gender neutral. So again, that idea of choice that we talked about earlier. And also that it would accommodate different kinds of activities. So a yoga room and a gym, like there's variety with that. Accessibility being important no matter where you are in the facility, and accessibility for any number of different reasons. We spent a bit of time talking about the welcoming space, having it be flexible, and even the flow of moving from one space to another. Is it comfortable and clear where people are going and not causing any discomfort to people moving about the facility? One of the participants actually was texting her daughter at the same time as we were talking. And so she got her to weigh in. And one of the things that she mentioned was this notion that boys and girls, men and women should have the same stuff, the same size change rooms, the same access to equipment, that it should be equal. And then the last one I'd mention is a choice of rooms that could be or spaces that could be made private from the outside viewer, but also could be opened up with blinds or curtains or something when it was more important or important to let light in, for example. So again, that flexibility.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Thanks, Nancy. Krista, did you want to share something from your breakout room?
Yeah, sure. So actually, Valentina had put this in the chat box, so I'm not sure if everybody saw it. But around having Indigenous groups participating in activities, but when they were in the facilities, they weren't permitted to smudge. And also drumming was something that was not as welcomed or accepted. So, and in part, I just asked if there was a specific reason. It was around the scent and the smoke. And so we talked about the need for facilities to make rooms available or spaces available for mm-hmm. Indigenous groups to be able to smudge and drum as well. Mm-hmm. And then we just talked about a program that was taking place at, or moving some program into the YMCA, which is traditionally, or in that town was traditionally a male space. And so just setting up the equipment in a certain way for the needs of the women, and then also setting it up in a way that was, you know, the colors that were in the foyer and having flowers and pictures of the kids being active and so on. So making it a really welcoming space for the women who are coming in to use that room. And then I, of course, who seem to be obsessed with age these days, asked about any thoughts around how, and again, the fact that we are an aging population. And so one of, I think Valentina again was talking about a program where they had Sensational 60s, which could be for women in their 60s, but also with 60s music. So, which ended up being an intergenerational space, but certainly welcomed women who of that age group and could have taken it both ways with the 60s music. Although I did say I grew up in the 60s, but I'm the disco sister, so not sure I would have gotten much out of the 60s music.
That's great. Thanks, Krista. And then for our breakout room, as I mentioned, everything went really quick and we decided to, you know, maybe focus a little bit about the discussion of age and how do you engage, what are the issues with age and gender equity? And so the first we sort of targeted was teens and talked a little bit about how, you know, the use of social media and e-newsletters was a really great way of getting feedback on promotion and reaching out to this age group. And so it actually does provide a lot of good awareness to that. It's actually very, very interesting because I think that the extrapolation of this concept of social media and accessing devices is in that one early example that we presented at the City of Richmond, one of the key reasons why the girls go up to that space is because we have USB chargers, you know, along a counter. So it really does promote, you can come here, you can sit, you can plug in your phone or your tablet or your computer, and you are able to actually use social media. And so that's one way that a lot of kids are coming into facilities. They're looking for that free Wi-Fi in order to access, in order to sort of access their own accounts, and that actually brings them into the facility, which then allows for staff to be able to promote programs to them. And of course, accessibility was sort of discussed in the other breakout sessions as well. So for older adults, you know, lighting was something that was brought up. It's really hard to see, and so if things aren't well lit, or if you don't feel safe, or you know, you're not able to access the spaces, it becomes really difficult. So there's a whole layer of accessibility that often gets is another lens that comes over top of facility design. Okay. For everyone as well. This is quite a nice tie-in, Nancy, as you were discussing, you know, that there was someone in your breakout room that was actually, you know, texting her daughter and talking about, you know, what are they looking for? And I think a lot of our understanding as to what really attracts teen girls to come into facilities is sort of done through focus groups, because we're not finding that these girls are actually in the facilities. And so reaching out to the various focus groups allow us to be able to get some better insight. And so in doing these focus groups, some sort of themes or very specific facility comments have actually come up. And so one thing that we like to do is we like to show a lot of images to the girls and say, what about this? What do you like about this? What don't you like about it? And it really starts to bring out, you know, a lot of commentary as to why girls would be attracted to facilities or not attracted to facilities. And so here are just a number of various different examples. And something that, you know, comes in are things like bright space and nice colors, you know, and you know, that can actually be unpacked in the focus group on its own is, what do you mean by nice colors? Or, you know, age group of staff. It was very interesting in a focus group, we heard someone say, I don't want teenager staff to help me. It's like, it's too intimidating when the person who's helping me is another teenager, but, you know, younger staff, not older staff. And so, you know, lots of very interesting pieces, but clean actually came up quite a bit. And that actually makes a really big impact on facility design, because for some reason, that actually comment comes out quite a bit when we talk to girls and women, is that this idea of cleanliness and not wanting to use a facility because it's perceived to not be clean, I think is something that's interesting. So take a look at this as I've been talking, all of the various different comments that have come up. And so when we take a lot of these comments and we talk about breaking them down into key themes, what we see is privacy. And that was sort of discussed in Erin's video that when she talked about, you know, how do we create privacy in natatorium spaces? How do we create privacy in gymnasium spaces? There is that aspect of safety, you know, the safety in terms of getting to the facility, feeling safe when you're within facilities, age-specific programming, and how that programming actually can really encourage various participation from females. There was an idea, especially when it came to young girls, is feeling unrespected when they walk into a facility. The idea that, I'm going into a facility, but because not only because of my gender, but because of my age, I sort of feel like I don't belong in that space. Co-location of programs came up as well in terms of schools and programming, and how when you put sport and exercise programs co-located close by to schools, or if there's that sort of exchange or partnerships with schools and facilities, that actually really encourages girls to utilize those sport facilities. And a part of that is because it gets the word out. And so sometimes when we do these engagement sessions and we show beautiful images of facilities that are really attractive to girls, they'll ask, I would love to go to this facility. How come I don't know about these facilities? So I think schools is a really big target for actually reaching out to young girls. I want to spend just a moment talking a little bit about data bias and how design of facilities are actually coming about. And as a designer myself for facilities, what are the sort of metrics that we use when we do design? And so this was not on a reading list, and it is available in public libraries, but there is a book called Invisible Women, Data Bias in a World Designed for Men. The author is Caroline Carrillo Perez. And the next, this slide here is really, a summary of some of the comments that she has out of her book. And so I do believe that there is going to be resources posted. So the book is going to be on that resource list. But when we take a look at something like washrooms, urinals versus cubicles, and making all male and female washroom genderless is a situation that often makes it worse for women. Because when you think about these facilities, typically building codes ask that we actually provide more toilet stalls for women than for men. But if you all of a sudden make everything gender neutral, oftentimes what happens is the women tend to be waiting longer, let's just say. And so that's something that has come up in facility design as well, is just making sure that the shared toilet rooms are actually going to accommodate, that are needing to accommodate both men and women, actually accommodate women and the numbers that they need, but not just all be sort of combined into one lump number of toilets. And the other is about the gymnasium and the concept that oftentimes what happens for women and men is, you know, from about the age of 10, the girls' presence within sort of public areas decreases significantly. And a large issue was the fact that these sort of single large open spaces, which where girls have to compete for boys, become an issue. So if you think about a gymnasium and oftentimes what that gymnasium is used for, you know, you may have a gymnasium that is for drop-in basketball that tends to be geared towards boys. And so creating those types of programmed spaces, or maybe being able to subdivide your gymnasium space so you can run sort of concurrent programming together, you know, boys drop-in basketball, girls drop-in basketball. So the competition for the space is sort of downplayed a little bit. I think that actually is something that would be much more equitable towards girls and women. The other is this concept of temperature and how women and men, you know, from a physiological point of view, they actually are perceive temperature in spaces differently. And so oftentimes, you know, our HVAC systems or our mechanical systems actually are geared towards what it is for a male of a certain weight and what are those preferred temperatures within spaces. And so oftentimes, you know, you could have a large space shared between men and women, and the women are sort of wearing their jackets and their sweaters and the men are feeling very comfortable. And so being able to understand how temperature sort of also plays an impact for gender as well is important. And so creating that flexibility in your spaces that allow for zoning or for allow for opportunities for that temperature to be changed actually is something that can cater towards a larger population and be more gender equal. And then the other one I just wanted to sort of mention a little bit is that the book also talks a little bit about how women tend to also access public transportation much more than men in many cities. And there are a lot of statistics that support that, but snow clearing for paths and routes to get to facilities often don't take into consideration that for women who may be taking children and young children or taking their strollers onto public transportation routes, if those routes from bus stops and stations aren't actually nice and clear for women to get to facilities, that tends to be a very, very large barrier. Okay, so this is Lisa O'Keefe, and she is from Sport England. And in this video here, she's just going to speak to influencing organizational culture and some strategies for gaining support and change towards greater gender equity. And I know that when we take a look at facility design, the budgets and the funds there able to support gender equity, I think making a case for that is sometimes very, very necessary. And so she talks to that in this video here.
The organization in question either has to want to do it. So hopefully they just think, actually, this isn't right that there are so many women and girls who are struggling to access our facility or are not sufficiently active in our community. So you would hope that they would want to be part of that. But if that is not enough, then thinking about why, finding a way to encourage and enable more women to access that opportunity delivers on the corporate goals. So what is it in that organization's strategy that can be delivered by more women or girls accessing that opportunity? I've certainly found that in the past with some of the sports that I've worked with, where they've just kind of said to me, well, I hear what you're saying, Lisa, but I don't think that market's actually there. I don't think there's all these women who want to take part in our sport. You know, we're not seeing it. We don't think they're there. And what I've been able to do is to demonstrate they are there. If you create the right opportunity for them, they will come to it. And that, of course, has an impact on the bottom line. So you've got to make that connection to the bottom line for these organisations. Once you've made that connection and you've got people interested in the fact there could be this great market opportunity we're not accessing, you've got to get to the decision makers, and you've got to get them in a place where they're listening to the voice of that potential customer. We've done that in lots of different ways. I've run focus groups where I've had the owners of the businesses behind the glass mirrors. I've videoed sessions and brought that in to show them. One, to reassure them that market is there, and it is an opportunity, but also because they are shocked when they hear other people's perception of their place. Whatever it is.
Okay. We showed this slide earlier in the presentation, and we're just going to unpack this a little bit more in a little bit more depth. Specifically, you know, when we're thinking about our planning considerations, discovery and defining what the issues are, we've done a little bit of that already in this workshop early on, is to say, what are our concerns here and how do we define them? And then take a look at the stakeholder engagement and the analysis that comes from that stakeholder engagement. So what we're looking for here is identify the need and then test out, are those needs real? And so it sounds like, and we did at the very beginning, sort of about half of the group that was on at the start of the workshop was sort of saying that engagement does happen and about half doesn't. But in order to really truly understand, you know, is this really a concern? That's something that needs to happen very early and upfront in the project. So the next part is taking a look at what is the burden and what is the benefit of making the change within the facility? And then is this advancing an opportunity and minimizing a harm? And that actually is a way for owners and clients and us as designers is understanding how do we actually translate and provide some real good examples as to how the changes are going to actually promote more gender equity. And so a lot of these are some planning considerations that we have here that sort of talk about, you know, how can we be really strategic in sort of making the changes that are necessary. And then the last part in the planning consideration is that evaluation, being accountable for that and assessing and reporting. And this is where that early question that we have, or is there any sort of data that actually shows that, let's say, gender neutral and universal change rooms without any dedicated male and female in a facility actually is working well, is addressing the entire population. This is what people want. And I think that we're still in the process, and the organizations that have really thought through this process are beginning to cycle back and look at that evaluation and be accountable for that. And the more data there is on this as people are working towards incorporating gender equitable design in their facilities, the better argument and proof there is for other facilities to sort of promote that as well. So that in terms of strategically planning, that's sort of a comprehensive way of going about facility change. And I just want Lisa to sort of continue again in this video is to talk about the changes and improvements in the facilities that have contributed to gender equity for Sport England.
please tell us about any changes in any of the facilities that you've been working with over time, whether they be large or small, that have proven to be some big improvements in attracting girls and women?
So the first point I would make about facilities, it is lovely to have new facilities. It really is. An investment in facilities is so important. But I have to say, actually, if it came to investing in new facilities or making sure that your existing facilities were such that the community felt really welcome in those facilities, that when they go in them, they feel comfortable and wanted, that actually is way more important than the actual age of the facility or the design of the facility. It's got to feel right for the community. But that said, I'm all for investment in facilities. And thinking actually back to an example, we invested in a series of pilots across England to try and encourage more women to swim. And we worked with a series of swimming pools across the country, and we worked with both the local authority who owned the facility and the leisure provider who ran the facility. So really important having both of them around the table. And what we found through speaking to our audience that we were targeting is that actually some small improvements to the facility stock does make a difference. And in a swimming context, you won't be surprised to hear that changing rooms always came top of that list in terms of swim facilities, but also the reception area. You know, was it open? Was it welcoming? The flow of the building. If you are completely new to a facility, is it really easy to kind of navigate your way around? Or actually, is it quite a labyrinth that it's really hard to understand where the route through to the changing rooms and the pool? Because if you don't feel comfortable in that environment, the last thing you want to be doing is wandering around looking lost as if you shouldn't be there. So we did find that opening up the reception area, just small improvements to the facilities, putting cubicled areas in instead of having the kind of open plan, changing villages, putting proper hair dryers and stuff, you know, straighteners. If you want people to exercise before they're going to work, you've got to help them make sure that when they leave that building, they're going to feel presentable for the next event that they're going to. So asking them what they want is really important. One of the other advantages of doing that, and just small investment in the facility, we found through our research, the staff who worked in those swimming pools felt an increased sense of pride in the facility because of, in some cases, you know, we were spending £10,000. In the grand scheme of things, nothing, but that created so much pride in the workforce. We were also excited they were part of a pilot, and it really created a much increased sense of motivation, pride and energy to really kind of get with the pilots and try and deliver on them because someone had invested in them.
Just love how she talks about their pilot projects and, you know, how you can sort of, as you're working on projects through your facilities, just getting that staff support for everyone to sort of back this pilot project, I think is really interesting. And I think that, you know, even though gender equity has sort of been on the forefront of many people's minds for many years now, and we feel that we've made a lot of steps towards creating more equitable spaces, that there's still all of these pilots that are actually being instituted in various organizations across the world. The next couple of slides are going to show some facility examples. And this first project here is actually about creating equity on two baseball fields. So baseball and softball. And the president of Heritage Service, which is a philanthropic organization in Omaha, Nebraska, had right off the bat in sort of developing these ball fields said that they were looking for equity in this project. That was key to the development of the design. And right off the bat, they wanted to make sure that you know, both fields that were developed, one that was geared more towards the women's side of the sport and the other geared more towards the men of side of the sport, was going to be equitable. And so that meant sort of the way the facility was being developed in terms of solar orientation was important. So as an example, baseball always got the best orientation where you want to face north to third base. And so that way, you know, the sun is never really in your eyes when you're sort of up on base. But we also understood that a new college orientation for softball, which is that smaller field, was also equal as well, that there were some advantages to having, you know, to having that field sort of oriented towards third base, towards the south. And so so that was something that was like really specific in the design of the facility and the placement of even the ball fields. And then there was this understanding that the amenities, which you see here in the Y-shaped buildings, was actually going to also be equal. So on top of the amenities, what you had is you had viewing facilities. And so you could equally view from that facility toward both ball diamonds, that you entered onto the ball diamonds in the same way, that you were able to access the concessions in the same way at the same, with the sort of same distance from the ball field to the amenity building. And that even in terms of looking at the seating, you can sort of see the seating for the baseball diamond is larger because they tended to draw a larger crowd. But if you think about, you know, sort of spectator venues, and when you've gone to a venue that actually drew a smaller crowd, and whether or not, you know, if you felt like that it just the stands were empty, and what that does for the players is there, it was purposeful that for the softball diamond that they actually sort of created less seating so that it felt fuller when people were going to watch that. And then there was that opportunity, you know, alongside as the sport became more and more popular to be able to add more seating there. So they had a few sort of more like bench seats here, and the opportunity to add on. And so there was quite a purposeful way of thinking about each ball diamond and how you can sort of be equitable for both. And these are just some of the images of that ball diamond and field from the amenity building. And you can sort of see that there was this access, the tunnel access for the players to get onto the field that was sort of equal and shared between them, that there was this open concourse so you can see both sides. And then even where they had sort of the media, that they would get great sort of media views and camera views from each side at that upper level. And just another sort of example of how there's that sort of shared vertical access too. It's sort of smack center between the two ball diamonds. And so there was that feeling of equality and equity as you were using the facility, and just a few images of the facility itself. So this is another project example that we wanted to share. And this project example had taken the children's piece of the facility and placed it up front and center so that as you're walking by the facility on street frontage, that's what you see. And so you can sort of see here, there's that sort of very colorful children's play area. And the reason that the location of that was placed is because this community has a lot of new immigrants and mothers with young children. And so through the engagement process, there was quite a bit of discussion through translators that women were feeling that, you know, they were new to Canada, and they had no way in Vancouver because it's so rainy here. There was no real good way for them to meet people when the weather was not very good. And so creating this sort of free and visual and highly colorful space to sort of attract children and young mothers to come into the facility was one way of bringing the community in. And so having that was a very, very purposeful design component of this facility. And so you can sort of see that once you've come in and the kids are sort of using the facility, there are seating areas outside that look in, but there's also other opportunities, you know, down the same lobby space to look into the gymnasium. So perhaps what brings you into the facility is this little children's play area, but what happens as a family for young moms, as well as young girls, is to be able to begin to see that there's other recreation, exercise, sport that can be introduced to families who may not be regular participants of sport. And so that transparency was very, very important in terms of the understanding. This is the same facility and plan. And so there were some very conscious decisions made to sort of encourage women to come into the facility. The first one is that playground that you see in number one, but there was also a very specific and close by breastfeeding room that was sort of a separated room from just the washroom space, so that women who brought young children also had an opportunity to have a private space with a comfy chair to actually use that breastfeeding room. We did provide universal washrooms in the form of unit washrooms, but also we also had the dedicated male and female for everyone who was not so comfortable with that. The social area and the cafe here was also very, very close to that front entrance, as well as to the playground area. And that was to continue to encourage people to utilize that facility. Reception was very easy. So there were some visuals from reception, but also that if you were confused or if you had a question, that reception was close by. And then we also created staff universal change rooms and dedicated ones as well, universal washrooms and change rooms, as well as that overall universal. And so in this case, half of the change rooms were universal, one quarter was male and one quarter was female. So when we consider design of the facility, it's not just the inside of the facility that we want to consider, but it's also all of the external environmental pieces for the exterior of the facility. So we want to have playgrounds that are within a reasonable distance and visible from all playing fields. So this is to sort of facilitate that oftentimes women come with children to facilities. And so for them to participate in sport, there has to be something that is engaging for their kids to participate in. We want clear lines of sight from building entrance to car parking areas, to social and multipurpose spaces, to assist with that passive surveillance and supervision. Because if a woman or a teen or a girl or someone who's not really feeling safe in the community or don't feel safe when they come into the facility, if that sense of safety isn't there, that perceived sense of safety is not there, then they tend to not want to access the facility. And then a building surrounding should allow for that passive surveillance, which we think is really important. There is a test, a sort of a site design test case that is in Delhi that is sort of talks a lot to how these external spaces can really sort of create a community harmony and sort of encourage more women and children to be utilizing sort of active as well as community type spaces. And so the top image here is sort of showing what the space looked like before. So there was car park, and then there was a vehicle access and street access. And then there was some barren lands. And this was a very specific location in Delhi that was really underused. And so there was quite this barrier to access. And so what they did is in the design and development, and after engaging women and talking to women about these spaces, they started talking about what actually would allow for more sort of community engagement and participation and reappropriating these public spaces so that they were more active spaces and engaging spaces for the community and neighborhood populations. And you can sort of see here is, you know, taking down sort of the large walls and sort of creating that open access, visible space. It feels safe, open air kitchens, because we hear a lot from women with families and also new immigrants when they come to communities, that they feel that food is sort of a common language for them. And so having community kitchens or places to buy coffee or opportunities for food in recreation environments are actually a really big piece of creating that community. Then there's that shared playing space, and then there's that open access for walking and reclaiming that walking, those walking areas, to make this much more pedestrian oriented. Here's another example where engagement has allowed young girls to actually contribute to what would create a safe space for them. And so in this example here, there was a number of spaces that were looked at where through the engagement with girls, and you can sort of see that there was this a creation through modeling with preteen and teen girls in terms of saying, well, what would you like to see in these spaces, right? And so what they said was, you know, we want spaces to make an impact. They want to break down those larger spaces into smaller spaces to create more of an intimate scale. They want it to be possible for them to be able to see everything around them, but not always to be on show and to be seen by others. They wanted to have spaces that created a bit of a shelter and had character that was engaging to girls and to provide better hangout opportunities. And so a really great example of how engagement can really form and change and transform spaces and add ideas that are going to draw this demographic to these underused places, public places. And then in terms of building design, you know, a lot of items that we wanna consider are items such as the configuration of the functions and where the adjacencies are located within the building so that there's that ease of accessibility for users. We talked earlier on about age and when you're an older demographic, how that becomes very difficult. And so when there are barriers, so it's hard for you to see or get to your next room or your next event within the facility, it does cause people to not want to access the facilities. And so as an example, you can sort of see in this lower image, this sort of linkage from one space to the other not only promotes those activities that are happening within the facility, but there are blinds here. These are sort of blinds in cases where if you want to create that more private environment for those people who are having a fear of you know, being seen, is that you're able to create those more private spaces. We want to create change rooms and washrooms that feel like they can provide privacy and security, but they feel like they're meant for all people. So oftentimes what we do is we take a look at the groups that would consider washrooms to be the ones that have the most barriers. So maybe this is someone in a wheelchair, and building codes, you know, throughout Canada actually dictate how high a sink or a mirror needs to be in order to facilitate that. And so what we do is we start creating spaces which can be accessed, any of the sinks can be accessed by those people who are in a wheelchair. It's not just the one sink. And so if you are, you know, coming into the space, you can go to the first sink, the second one, the third, the fourth, any of them, they all become sort of accessible and barrier free. And then of course, we want to sort of create that sort of open, welcoming environment so that you feel that if you have a question to ask, that you can access those spaces as well. So a couple of other points here is avoiding the creation of potential hiding places within a building so that you feel safe when you're in that space. And then durable materials are really important too, because that sense of cleanliness is a really big issue for a lot of women and girls and wanting to access the facility. And so keeping materials durable actually really helps in making the facility look good over the long term. We also, a number of other building examples to consider is where change room entry doors are highly public, is to just make sure that you are very careful with the sight lines. This happens a lot in older facilities where, you know, especially in arena facilities, which were mostly geared towards team sports for boys, where you open up the door into those sort of group change rooms, and you can see everyone changing in the space. And what's happening is, as more girls are accessing hockey, let's say, is the sense of privacy becomes a really big barrier for them as well. And so that the sight lines into spaces to create more privacy is very, very important. When we ensure that all user amenities are designed to unisex and universal standards, you want to just make sure that everything is there to accommodate sort of all genders and sexes, and be able to facilitate that change, that sort of change activity for girls and women's, as well as for men and boys. Design should be flexible. And we talked about this as having concurrent programming, being able to separate out boys and girls, especially in programs where girls feel very intimidated, actually may work very well. And so lots of opportunities to be able to separate large spaces into smaller spaces. And then consider sort of those social gathering spaces as being a really great way of bringing people into the space prior to a sport activity, and then after a sport activity, and potentially for those people who don't actually participate in sport, bringing those people in. And so here's Lisa again, and this is the last little video clip we have of her. And then she talks about implementation in this video.
And what we found was that in order to transform swimming and to transform the experience of the people who were going to the pools, we had to have a package of improvements. And we found that that package of improvements, the most important improvement was customer service. Singularly, the most important improvement in all of the pilots that we ran. And that's customer service the whole way through the customer journey. So from that point when somebody picks up their phone and they're trying to find your activity, right through to the welcome when they turn up, their experience taking part in that activity, all the way through to what happens to them when they leave that building and what happens in the few days or weeks afterwards, that whole customer journey, you really, really have to be on your A game in terms of customer service. Beyond that, we found the in-pool activities. Again, asking people what they wanted to do, they were telling us, well, actually, what we don't want to do is just bob around in a pool. We want to have access to lots of different classes. We want to have access to fun and exciting equipment. It's got to be engaging. It's got to be exciting. It's got to be rewarding. You want to feel the health benefits from it. So making sure that program of activities is right, making sure that you've got the best facilities and equipment that you can, and that they really kind of deliver what your audience want. The other one was information. So many of our sports facilities are behind walls, are behind hedges, are, these big buildings, and we have no idea what's going on in there if we've never been in. And if you are somebody who's not taken part in that activity since you left school, which in my case is going to be, 30 years ago, I will have a perception of that activity that's 30 years old. And if I've never been in there, how do I know what's going on? So we have to find a way of bringing that forward. I talk a lot to people about, how difficult is it for staff just to go around with a phone and show you the customer journey? Here's the reception. Here's how you would get to the pool side. How difficult is it to kind of really immerse people in the experience that's going on? So information is key. And connected to that, of course, is marketing. And we invest a lot of time. And in fact, we just about to release a new resource for our sector, which really helps with marketing, and particularly digital marketing, because it is more possible now than ever before to literally put yourself in front of the customer that you're trying to target. But we're quite rubbish at knowing how to do that. Nobody ever taught us. So that's really important as well. And we make sure that all of our pilot projects have a sufficient marketing budget and help from experts who know how to do it well, because leaflets in reception areas of buildings that people will never go into ain't going to cut it. And then finally, community outreach. Again, I can't stress this one enough. All of our research has shown us that for a lot of women and girls, it takes a lot of prompting to finally try activity.
Okay, and as we're rounding out our presentation, we're getting close to the end. This was a really great article that sort of came across my browser when I was doing research for this project. And it's very interesting because in France, you know, France has banned the use of burkinis in swimming pools. And so because many people in that country sort of regard the swimsuit as a symbol of political Islam. And then so what happened is in this article, a group of women actually just, they came in, they really did want to sort of say, look, what you have done is you've sort of limited our ability to access these pools. We just want to actually swim. We just want to be able to utilize facilities like other people. And, you know, our culture doesn't allow us to do so if you do that. And so it's just a really great comment from one of the individuals that was interviewed for the article. And they said, we have a dream to have fun in public swimming pools like all other citizens, to accompany our children wherever they want to have a swim when it's hot in the summer here in Grenoble. And so I think that our perception of certain groups and certain populations, you know, that engagement and ability to really understand what the needs are and what the hopes and desires are is really important. And that engagement really helps sort of unlock a lot of interesting and perhaps unknown sort of sentiments towards facilities. And so there are a number of articles, resources, and web links that has gone into helping create this presentation today that we encourage you to sort of take a look at as well, and provides more in-depth opportunity for understanding some of the slides that we sort of gone through very, very quickly. And then at this point here, Krista, did you want to talk about the gender equity toolkit?
Sure. And yeah, I was going to say, I'll talk about this and then we can invite people to ask some questions. I know that there is one in the chat box, but maybe I'll just quickly tell you about, yes, the new toolkit that we just launched. When we started on this project, oh my gosh, almost 2 years ago, we started off by doing a few things. We did a literature review. We did an environmental scan to see what was out there. Particularly on the topic of facility use and design, and I would say there's not a ton. We did some key informant interviews, about 40 with people across the country, and then we did surveys or a survey of recreation leaders. And what came up was the fact that every community is different. And so they're not uniform across the country. The needs and wants will not be the same. And so what we decided to do is tackle this from a slightly different perspective, which was around capacity building. And so that's what these workshops are meant to do, is provide some capacity to leaders in three different areas, which again came out as very strong themes that people needed help with. One was community engagement, and Lisa O'Keefe talked about it in this video clip. She talked about the fact that we've got to talk to people in communities. So that one is actually taking place in March. March 9th, I believe it's the 8th or 9th. I have so many webinars going on in my brain. And then we have organizational culture change. We just actually did a workshop on organizational culture change, and it's on in the toolkit, and on evaluation. So that's how the toolkit has been designed. It gives you a little bit of an overview of the topic and the facts and the stats. The 2035 goal that we talked about at the beginning. And then it's broken down into those four areas of focus. So again, community engagement, organizational culture change, evaluation, and then facilities, which is the workshop that you're in today. So what you'll, when you go in there, you'll find links to the webinar or to the workshops. MJ, our technical guru, does edit them. So it's not going to be the full 3 hours. I think by the time you watch the video, it's closer to two and a bit. And the slide deck will be there, which you'll also, which will be circulated. Then there's a bunch of other resources. So some, for instance, that Mary talked about today in her workshop, those resources you'll find in that section of the toolkit. And then there's an entire section dedicated to resources, which we're continuing to add to. We're really lucky. We'll be carrying on this project for another couple of years. And so we're just sort of getting up and running on what that's going to look like. But and then the last piece of this toolkit is stories. So sharing stories from across the country. Some of them you've seen snippets of today from Aaron and from the folks at Sport Nova Scotia. And again, as I mentioned earlier, if you've got stories of what you're doing, actually Erica McDonald, who's on our call today, I chatted with her a few weeks ago, and we're going to share her story of what they're doing in City of Vancouver, and she's put a note in the chat box as well. So anything that you're doing that we can share across the country, we'd love to. And so this is just a beginning, this toolkit. We're going to be building on it over the next couple of years. And we always welcome your input, both from what you're doing, but also what else you'd like to see on this topic. So I think that's it on the toolkit.
That's great. Thanks. I'm looking forward to digging in there too myself. So we do want to, we've just got a few minutes left, is have you do a evaluation. The evaluation is very important to us because it really helps us refine our workshops and presentations for future. And so I encourage you to do that. We also, do we have a couple of questions in the chat, and maybe we can, share some stories. I think that there was the one about the smudging rooms, which was a great story to share. So.
Mary, I'll maybe jump in. I'm sorry, my Zoom froze, so I had to exit for a couple minutes to get reconnected. So I might be repeating what others have said, but I just wanted to point people into the chat box. When we did the last take up of the breakout rooms from the mural exercise, it looked like Aaron's group didn't have any stickies to report back on. They were having a problem with mural. And so Aaron's posted in the chat box the ideas from their group around this environmental supports. So just to let people know to have a quick look at those. The two questions, and it came up at the beginning as a verbal question, and now again to about midpoint, is around research or evidence based on the universal change room kind of trend. And so I think that's something that we will commit to doing some follow-up on and sending people what we can the toolbox place will be a perfect venue to host it in. But the two people in particular who have asked the question, we'll make sure we get back to you on that front. And I think, those were the only other questions. There's been a couple of comments.
Sorry, Nancy, I was going to mention that somebody asked if, Jennifer asked if you could just show the slide with the links again and the references.
Sure can.
You can just put that up for a sec. And yeah, this presentation will be made available in a PDF format, and it's also on YouTube as well.
Mm-hmm. Definitely, there are some leading communities that have really thought this through, and a lot of their resources are actually part of this. You can sort of see in terms of the interviews that we had, there's still a lot of communities, even though they've made a lot of good steps forward, they still have a lot of pilot projects, right? And so it's not as if this is all sort of worked out and sorted out. And as Krista said, every community is different, surprisingly different. And the demographics that make up that community then create facilities that are very specific to that community.
Erica's put a comment in the chat about needing help overcoming resistance to accommodating roller derby into the facilities, predominantly female, LGBTQ oriented, real resistance because of the damage that can occur.
So is that more of a question in terms of making really resilient and durable facilities so that it can accommodate that program? No, I think that's what it's.
And I think in reaction to-
I can jump in. Yeah, sure. We've been struggling with this for a few years, and I'm hoping that, you know, in this process or somebody else has some experience in this, we're trying to overcome the resistance just strictly from, hey, it's going to damage our facility, we're not going to accommodate it, to how can we figure out how to accommodate it? Mm-hmm. You know, we want to make that transition, and it's the same for all roller sports. Because of the perceived or actual damage that could occur. So it's just something we've been struggling with. We haven't found the solution yet. We've reached out to a number of different folks in our system, but there's a real, they just, you know, we just can't get people over the hump of the one issue that is their major barrier for accepting it.
Mm-hmm. I think it's very interesting because when you consider sports like hockey and arenas, you know, they've obviously been able to overcome that, right? And so skates in lobbies and rubber flooring and pucks and dasher boards and nets, like definitely, I think it's, you know, the sports that have been popular in communities have gotten the attention, and they build arenas all over the place. So I think that, you know, there's a counter argument to, well, there are sports out there that are very damaging to facilities, and they are abused, but there's that understanding that they will be. Okay, great. And I see that MJ has also put up a SurveyMonkey as well, a link for everyone to respond to. So we actually do have a couple of minutes. I don't know if there are any other questions or if we got through all of the questions.
Those were the questions that we have in the chat. I don't know if anybody has anyone that they have right now. They can just put up their hand, put it in the chat, or unmute themselves and go ahead.
The other thing that would be helpful to know, Krista touched on this with the toolkit, and similar to what Erica's done, is to flag areas maybe as a result of today or coming into today that you're struggling with, and would appreciate, we're creating a community of practice, and we're going to look at the toolkit contents. So if there are areas that you would love to see stuff around, and we can do some digging for you, that would be mm-hmm. great to know about those.
Well, definitely the universal or the gender-free washrooms. I think that is a very, very interesting one. And so it's been debated quite a bit, actually, on many facilities. Almost every facility that I have actually worked on is a big discussion over what and how. And I think that actually is something that is very very relevant to today's facility design, and also creating and taking existing sort of dedicated male and female and converting some of those to gender free, and what that means to the community. Okay, yeah, then.
Semestrics, I had two sciences.
Yeah, and for nutrition, it was kind of boring today. That period felt like it took like an hour.
Oh, I'm not quite sure if someone was caught mid-sentence, or I can't see who was speaking.
It was Sandy.
I don't think she liked the lunch you served Nancy today.
I know. It's something about nutrition, I thought.
I'm not that impressed with the lunch today.
Oh, I don't see her on the call any longer, though.
Okay. Maybe something happened there. Yeah.
There's nothing else in the chat. I don't see anybody else's hand raised. So let me just take the opportunity to say thank you, Mary, for your excellent leadership on this issue and the amount of digging and shaping of this. Thank you so much for the examples and all your experience on this. Thank you to the others from CPRA who helped with our workshop facilitation when we were in the breakout rooms. And most of all, thank you to all of you for your time. We know this is a big investment of time and really wanted to dig into the topic more than what you can do in a 1 hour sort of front-facing webinar. So this has been a great opportunity to get to know lots of you better. And hopefully we'll see you around the toolkit and on the bench with CPRA. So thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay. Take care, folks.
Thanks all.